here with Marita Golden. Marita Golden has earned a multitude of literary achievements as a novelist, essayist, university professor, and an institution builder for Black writers. Welcome, Marita Golden.
Thank you, Ethelbert.
You know, you recently undertook a trip to Israel, and I wonder, did you ever have a desire to visit that country?
Actually, no. I think that, like a lot of people, the prospect of the Middle East and the continuing conflict there seems so daunting. I did want to go to Egypt, and I did want to see Egypt, but Israel, frankly, was not on my list of countries. But it was a very, very good, transformative trip, so I'm very glad that I went.
How did you prepare for the trip? Did you read certain books? Did you do some searching online? Did you talk to people?
That's a very good question. Initially, as I approached my trip, going as a senior specialist for the Fulbright Foundation, like a lot of people, I said, okay, I have to really bone up on the Middle East. And I tried to find contemporary Israeli novelists to read. And then kind of in the middle of it, I remembered how in so many of my travels, the most important thing had been not to know everything before I went, but to be open to discovery once I got there. And so there came a point when I simply stopped reading and said, it's going to be good as long as I take an open mind and an open heart. And that's exactly what happened. I knew a lot about the conflict. I'd read numerous books in the past about Jewish history, Palestinian history. So I knew a lot. But I think that really when you're traveling, I always travel not to see the sights, but to see the people. And one thing I did not do when I was there is I did not visit the Holocaust Museum. I had a very busy schedule. And there was one day when I was going to try to fit it in. But I was really more interested in meeting and talking with and being engaged with living Israelis than visiting a monument to Jewish victims of hatred in the past.
You know, when you look at the last several years, and you're a public figure and a noted writer, Israel's always been problematic within the African American community. People concerned about the various sides, whether you support the Palestinians, whether you support the Israelis. We went through a point where people were making connections between Israel and South Africa.
Right.
Did you ever think about the political fallout of taking a trip to Israel?
No, I saw it. I was a little afraid initially for my safety. And my husband said, well, have you read the Washington Post? You'll be safer in Tel Aviv than in Southeast Washington. Yeah. So once the safety thing, I got over that, I really didn't think about the political fallout. There's a point where I really feel like I went as a Palestinian because I really have a certain feeling about, I really identify with the historical narrative and dispossession of Palestinians. And I identify with the price that they've had to pay for the state of Israel to come into being. But the reason the trip was so transformative was that I met many progressive Israelis who were deeply, deeply concerned about the future of their country, working for reconciliation, working for peace. And I feel like, in a sense, I came back as an American citizen, a Palestinian, and a Jew. And I'm very glad that I was open to hearing all these diverse voices. So it transformed me in realizing that, and this is the beautiful thing about literature, so many of the people that I was meeting and talking to were poets and writers. We're not smarter than anybody else. But because we're working with literature and language and creativity, very often we can find a little space, a little oasis, where we can, for a moment, forget the left, forget the right, and connect as people. And that's the great thing about literature, I think.
You know, when we look at literature, especially African-American literature, we know that many of the themes that influence it are sometimes biblical themes. Did you see yourself and say, oh, Rita Goldberg, I'm on my way to the Holy Land?
That's, well, there was some of that. There was, and it was very, I took a tour of the all the sites related to the life of Jesus. I took a picture in the Garden of Gethsemane. But even there, I found that there were walls and barriers. Muslims controlled this part of it. Greek Orthodox controlled this part of it. Calvary was controlled by, so that even in these sites that are supposedly quote holy, the profane, the political, haunted those sites as well.
Let me ask you this: you're a writer, okay? You're not a painter. You're not a musician. So you read the Bible. You read, you know, spiritual texts. But now you're actually seeing the Wailing Wall. I mean, you're looking at something visual. How does that affect you as a writer?
That was very, very profound. And my Israeli hosts were enormously generous. What happened was one of the professors at the University in Jerusalem, Bar Ilan, invited my husband and I to share Shabbat dinner with her family. And before we had Shabbat dinner, which is the beginning of the Jewish Sabbath, we went to the Wailing Wall, and she gave me a little scarf to wear on my head, and it was an absolutely amazing sight. It was so familiar, and it was so strange. On the one hand, you have this huge wall split down the middle so that the men are on one side and they're ecstatically jumping to show praise to God. On the other side, the women are dressed, and the young girls, and they're demurely, quietly praying. But as I walked through this crowd, this throng of women, I could have been at church on Sunday. The young girls were dressed in what would be their Sunday best. Some of them were very fervently praying. Some of them were gossiping about boyfriends. I wanted to get very close to the wall so that I could scribble on a piece of paper my wish and stick it in. I wasn't able to get close to the wall, but I was able to get into a mindset where I simply prayed for peace. And I think that was the most important thing. And then after that, we went back to the home of this professor and shared a Shabbat dinner. And yes, we talked about the Gaza Strip. We talked about the war. The Israelis that I met had no problem broaching the issue. And they had no problem engaging my husband and I when we differed, embracing us when we were on common ground.
But you know, you look at the wall and you go past the wall and you went into East Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
What's the difference?
Very different. When you're in Israel proper, you are in a very prosperous, secure, functioning state. That's quite impressive. And when you go into East Jerusalem, the atmosphere, the air is different. Everything is different. And you feel the sense of oppression. You feel the sense of blocked opportunities. You just feel it. And so there's a sense in which going to Israel was both to be in the presence of some of the most progressive people I've met in a long time, yet it felt like I was in a time warp. This is 2009, Barack Obama is president, and yet we have a wall which harkens back to 1950s segregation. And even though the two situations are not in any way comparable, it was very much like being in a time warp. And many of the Israelis that I met were very aware of that. And in our conversations, I heard guilt and shame and embarrassment, defensiveness, patriotism. I heard everything. But you know, it's interesting when you're visiting a place, as long as you're not visiting as an undocumented person, but as an official person, one of the most interesting incidents was at this Shabbat dinner. And before we had dinner, after we came back from the Wailing Wall, a young woman came in, and she was the daughter of one of the faculty members at the university. And we talked about film. She was a filmmaker. She was a poet. We talked about poetry slams. Just a wonderful conversation. Felt a real connection with her. So once we sat down to eat dinner, of course, we started talking about the conflict. And this same young woman said some things that I thought were quite odious. I mean, she there in a very calm voice, she had her whole narrative that was, she could cite Bible chapter and verse as to why the Palestinians had no rights that she needed to respect. Mm-hmm. Go on from there. And it was very interesting that because we'd made initially a connection as two women artists, even though I found her comments odious, I could look past that. And when I left the dinner, I actually hugged her, because despite her views, that wasn't the most important thing. It was the most important thing was that we were trying to connect despite that, as women, as artists, as people. You've got to stay engaged. That, I think that's the thing I learned. You've right. got to stay engaged.
Now, you prepared some lectures. You evidently had to decide what you were going to talk about. What did you select to do?
Well, I was asked to give two public addresses, one at the Tel Aviv University and one at Bar-Ilan. Ironically, both of them honoring Israelis who had died too soon. At Bar-Ilan, it was an annual ceremony honoring Shandy Rudolph, who had been the driving force behind the creation of the creative writing program there. And she was just a very talented, energetic young woman who was loved by everyone there. And in the day or two leading up to my talk, I got to talk with people at the university about her, and they spoke about her with so much reverence. She was a writer, teacher, and institution builder. And so I could really identify with her, and I felt a strange kind of sisterhood with her. And so I talked about how we get the, I talked in both places, but in different ways, about how we get the authority to speak as writers. And I talked about her as a literary institution builder, and how we all, even I, stood on her shoulders. She died at 40 of cancer. And I was there because she had preceded me. She had created something that created a space where writers could write, be, and become. And in at Tel Aviv University, there was a young man who was a student there and who had died in the 1973 war. And his father had underwritten an annual award for really outstanding writers in the English department. And so there I continued talking about some of those same things. But it was interesting, they teach American studies in these universities in Israel. American studies is a very popular class. And so they were studying the work of Ntozake Shange, Lorraine Hansberry. And I was asked by one professor to suggest an essay that students could read and then we could talk about it. And I suggested James Baldwin's essay, Stranger in the Village. And it was very interesting what the professor said. She said that very often, because Israelis have such a difficult time talking about Palestinians, they use African-American writers as surrogates to examine questions of identity, race, and relationships with the other. Now, there were Palestinians all around me. There were Arabs in the classroom. When I went to Jaffa in Jerusalem, there were Palestinians, because that was originally a Palestinian section. They're Palestinian Christians. But because my trip was officially sponsored by Israelis, much of what I learned about their lives, I learned through the voices of progressive Israelis.
When you teach, whether it's Baldwin, or you take Ntozake's work, or you take Maya Angelou's work, and you teach it to an audience that's not African American, not American, do you see, as a teacher, the response from these students now give you new insight into these texts?
The insight that you get is how universal our stories are. When I spoke in a class, an autobiography class, they were reading, or had finished reading, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. And the professor had asked the students to write a letter to Maya Angelou, giving her feedback. And one young woman in the class was very, very fair, very, very pale. And she spoke in her letter to Angelou of growing up in Israel among Sephardic Jews, who are your complexion, my complexion. And she was the only light-skinned girl in this whole community. And how she was teased and called whitey, and her self-hatred was so deep that she would lay in the sun for hours, and she got second-degree burns trying to get darker. And she thanked Maya Angelou for writing about her issues, her reverse issues, because Maya Angelou's story gave her a place where she could revisit her pain, but understand that she could get beyond it. So the eternal lesson is always that these stories are so universal, they're so powerful, and that we're really joined by them.
You know, when you mentioned that, I know you met two of my friends, and we talk about storytelling. What was your impression of Alan Hoffman?
Oh, Alan was wonderful. Now, Alan is an Orthodox right. Jew
funny guy.
From St. Louis, with his wonderful wit, wonderful humor, a great storyteller. We were taking the bus to an hour-long drive to Bar-Ilan one morning. We discovered everything. By the time we got on the bus, we were like separated birth twins. We discovered that War and Peace was our favorite novel of all time. He told me funny stories about Russian Jews and his wife. He's just a great, great guy. And I could tell that we had very different views about the conflict. But that didn't matter. That didn't matter. He created a space where that didn't matter.
You see, you also created a nice space between you and Judy Lamperson. Talk about her.
Yeah, Judy is the coordinator of the creative writing program at Bar-Ilan, and she's just wonderful. She's a nonfiction writer and a fiction writer. And what I loved about her is that Alex said that she's sort of the rock in the department around which everybody else orbits, because she has very strong political views that are very sympathetic to Palestinians, and yet she's secular. And so because she's a non-practicing Jew, everybody else in Bar-Ilan is more or less fairly Orthodox. She becomes the timeout person, where everybody is sort of working on their best behavior. She's the mediator. And in fact, I'm going to read a short excerpt from a wonderful story she wrote about the cost of war on the people who call themselves victors.
Let me pull you from these friendships that you just mentioned, new friendship, and take you back. When you were growing up, did you ever interact a lot with the Jewish community?
I attended American University, and there's a...
Before American University.
Not much before American University. But it was when I was in college and afterwards. My name alone, we suspected that there are Jewish...
The golden part.
Exactly, the golden... that they're Jewish.
And there's the Marina somewhere else, right?
There's a Jewish connection. Right. But once I got into college, there were many Jewish professors who were enormously... supportive of me, and my mentor, my longtime writing mentor, who taught me some fiction writing classes when I was in New York at the New School, and who called me up one Sunday morning and told me, he said, you know, I don't know what you're going to do with your life, but you're the greatest thing since sliced bread. You're so talented. This guy named Sidney Offit, and he and I have been friends since 1972. And the relationship between the Jewish community and the Black community is very, very interesting, because on the one hand, the philanthropic efforts of progressive Jews have funded everything from the civil rights movement back to many schools and universities. Many of the one-room schoolhouses that existed in the South were able to be built because of the philanthropic efforts of the Sears Roebuck people.
Right.
The Rosenwalds. And yet, at the same time, there's also the reality that in places like Harlem, Jews were often slumlords. Okay? So we have a very intense, intricate, complicated relationship.
Let's make it a little more complicated.
Yeah.
since the election of Obama, we've seen almost these tremors taking place that you could probably go back to the election, whether it's Japan, whether it's Iran. Now that you're in the Middle East, did you get a sense of Obama's impact on the population?
Well, among the communities that I was in, there was enormous excitement about his election, and there still is. I know Judy said that there were parties all over Jerusalem waiting for the results. People were crying, so there was enormous support. Many young people came up to me and said, Obama has to force us to do what we have to do to make peace. We will not be able to do it on our own. So even though in the months, in the 5 or 6 months since I went, there has been probably some dampening of that enthusiasm because Obama has pushed so hard on the settlement issues. The emails that I continue to get from many people when he spoke in Cairo, they were ecstatic. So he is respected. And you have to understand that it's a very, that what we read in the Washington Post is only part of it. What we read in the New York Times is only part of it. Israelis have as many different views about the situation as, you know, you'll read on the one hand, a Palestinian family was just thrown out of a house in East Jerusalem that they lived in for 50 years, and soldiers made them, you know, leave that house. And then you'll read that a group of Jews had formed a legal effort to keep them in the house, okay? So that what I learned was it's a very, it's not black or white, really. It's a very gray situation.
How do you feel your trip will affect your future storytelling?
That's a very good question. You're a very good interviewer. I think it will affect my future storytelling in that I will learn how important it is for me. I've learned how important it is for me as a writer, and how important it will be for my characters and all the subjects that I approach to stay engaged, to not shut down. You know, there's something great about when you're traveling in a country and you sort of have to be on your best behavior. You know, you sort of have to say, well, I shouldn't say that, and you're forced to listen. Because in this country, we're completely nuts now. We've lost all civility, and we, you know, loony lefty, you know. But there's really something interesting about being forced to be quiet and listen to the other person. And that's what came, that's one very, and as an artist and as a writer, you have to listen to all sides. And one thing I was trying to do when I wrote the lecture is, I think of it as a quilt. That has a number of different pieces. So there's everything from conversations that I have with students in the classroom to meditations on what I've seen, poetry by some of the Israeli poets I met. I insert the voice of people like Edward Said, so that I'm trying to bring a lot of things together. In this talk I'm giving, some of it actual, some of it recreated.
You're going to be talking in the public library. What would you tell the audience? Are there any books that you would direct them to? I mean, you met a number of writers. You yourself talked about the importance of sharing James Baldwin. Coming off a trip like this and making it meaningful to other people in a library setting, mm-hmm. what can you instruct them to do in terms of, well, go out and not just listen to me, but go read this or, mm-hmm. or go pick mm-hmm. up this newspaper, this mm-hmm. magazine? What would you mm-hmm. recommend to people?
Well, I would recommend that they seek, for example, alternative sources of information about the situation in the Middle East, that they go to the Jerusalem Post on the internet. They try to get Al Jazeera, which is great. I mean, we live in an area now where you can actually get Al Jazeera. That they listen to Democracy Now!, that they read. There's a whole lot of really wonderful contemporary Israeli writers who are writing about, who are challenging the received historical mythology about the creation of Israel in some interesting and new ways. And so there's a wealth of information out there. They have to give themselves permission to go get it.
You know, you talked a lot about politics, but when we look at some of your last books, you've always talked about love. Putting this trip together, did this, you know, being in the Holy Land, you know, visiting the Middle East, did it teach you anything about love? I mean, when we associate the Middle East, we think about hatred and things of that sort. Did it reaffirm anything in terms of what you've been reading in other people's work, what you've been talking about? But when you come back to things like love and compassion, did this trip sort of give you a new vocabulary?
Well, it just reaffirmed how hard love is to practice and how necessary it is to do. Because when you talk about peace in the Middle East, a lot of what you're talking about is individuals being at peace with themselves first and then trying to be at peace with each other. And what I saw in Israel was a deeply wounded country that had, with a lot of trauma inflicted from the outside and self-inflicted because of the walls that it has built. And so a lot of the love has to be with you first. A lot of the peace has to be with you first. A lot of the honesty has to be with you first. But just how hard it is, but how necessary. And also how wonderful it is. For example, as to go back to when I hugged that young woman, and in fact, who I'm talking about is Alan's daughter. I really felt a moment of profound connection with her that transcended our political differences. I mean, those moments are very rare. I probably had three in my life, but that was one of them. And the trip, if you know, was worth it for that, and worth it for the friendships that I've made. Yeah.
Well, this has been a wonderful moment for me, Marita. I don't get a chance to sit down and offer to talk with you, but they are wonderful moments, and I thank you and what you continue to do. Marita Goldman.
Thank you.